All right, guys, thanks for joining. We are here with Ebony Kenney. She is from Florida, now in California. She's an AdamandEve.com affiliate. She is 5'1" tall. She has a YouTube channel called Magic, Sex, and Coffee. She was a previous WPT player to watch. She is polyamorous. You're going to have to Google that one. And she is the only 1% of the population that can get off from nipple play. That's right. 1%. A very unique guest to have on the show, and we're glad to have you. Welcome, Ebony.
Whoa, those are some pretty awesome highlights.
I did my research.
That's so great.
Excellent, excellent. It's great to have you. I've watched all of the YouTube videos you have out there. They're very educational and interesting.
Yeah, they're definitely, I mean, I just started, so it's new. Not new for me, but new for the people who don't know me.
For sure. Nothing to hide, you know? It's a common thing.
Yeah, not at all.
Excellent. The chat seems to enjoy the 1% stat. Can you expound a little bit on that?
Yeah, so I was just reading. I mean, I think females have a hard time with orgasms anyway, but a very, very small percentage of the population, approximately 1% of the female population, can have orgasms from nipple play. So,
wow.
And I am one of the lucky ones. So,
I mean, without going too much into detail, how would one achieve that from a male's strategic standpoint?
Oh, I mean, there's all kinds of, I mean, there's so many different ways. It's just, and honestly, it depends on your partner and how she what she responds to. There's squeezing, punching, flicking, all kinds of soft licking, whatever. There's a bunch of stuff. So,
squeezing, touching, licking, that order.
Squeezing, pinching, all of it. Anything.
Stimulation.
Yeah, I mean, and then yeah, there's, and then avoiding and going back and. There's a bunch of different ways. But yeah, if you just take your time and and try.
Okay. I feel that. That's something I learn something new every day, right? I did appreciate a lot of the information that you presented in your videos on a serious note, especially the how to approach a girl for the first time subject. I know a lot of guys are very intimidated by that, the fear of rejection. You went over all that, and some of the main points I wrote down that I really liked was you talked about touching a girl on the small of her back. timing of that seems like it could go horribly wrong if you just start off with that. It's got to be once you already broke the ice.
Yeah, it's not like you just go and you're just like instantly snap, oh, let me just touch her on the small of her back and hope she responds well. No, it's if you – it's one of those, if you get compelled to do it and you feel like it's the right moment, then chances are it's the right moment. Like if you're questioning yourself and you're like, I don't know, should I do it now? Or, you know, it's just one of those, you kind of, hopefully you're good enough to read the situation and you don't really overthink things or overanalyze, and just remember that you're both really nervous, especially if it's the initial date, you know, she's just as nervous as you are. And I think guys tend to think that they're the only ones that are nervous. So if you really just think that she's just as nervous and you just take a deep breath and it's not that big of a deal, and, you know, be comfortable with your own touch before you try to implement touch on someone else. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. You got to go with the rhythm, go with the flow. In general, I see myself touching a small of a girl's back when I'm kind of like almost, you know, guiding her, saying, you know, go ahead, go this way ahead of me. Or when you're walking next to her, you know, you open the door and you give her a little pat.
Yeah.
But if you were walking down the street, you wouldn't just keep your hand on the small every bit.
Yeah, it's those small little moments, exactly like the guiding and stuff like that. It's those small moments that are, they seem like such tiny, unimportant things, but for women, it's, there's so much. And for me, that's what I remember. I remember the guys that, exactly when I'm getting out of the car, they help me up and then they like kind of slowly like touch the small of my back. Or whenever we're waiting for something, you know, or we're waiting for a table and they kind of guide me to a different spot. It's those moments, or when we are both laughing about something and they just like slightly touch me or whatever. It's those moments, those small seconds of touch that spark heat and friction between two people. And okay. Help spark heat between two people that you don't realize, like maybe I didn't realize that there was, that I was like super physically interested. Maybe it's taking me a little longer. And that moment, it makes me think, it could initiate me thinking, oh, okay, like now, you know, it also shows confidence from the man. So because if you're confident enough to touch me, to touch a woman in such a normal way without any, like there's no destination, then that shows so much confidence.
Okay. No, that makes a lot of sense. Just that, they say even petting an animal, petting your dog releases in hormones that make you feel less stressed. So I could see there's some sort of, chemical connection with just touching another human that makes them more attractive to you.
Yeah. Okay. The comments are hilarious right now because I don't think people knew that we were going to talk about sex at all. It's so funny.
Oh, okay. Well, you know, we can discuss numerous subjects, poker.
Oh, I don't care. Yeah. I think you're prepping your viewers.
Oxytocin. That is the chemical I was looking for when touching another human or dog. Stress relieving hormone. From a viewer, Rich, 23484. Thanks, Rich. The other keynotes I had was eye contact, speak clearly, and be direct upon first time talking to a girl. Can you talk a little bit more about those?
I mean, for me personally, I know that I respond well to, I'll take the guy that comes to me directly and just talks to me with no pretense of how to impress me. And he's just himself and introduces himself and makes direct eye contact and treats me like a human being. That goes so much further than somebody who is nervous or overthinking everything. And I know that these are all high pressure situations, but again, it goes back to she's just as nervous as you are. There's so much pressure when it comes to dating. So if you just speak clearly and just talk to me like you actually are interested in what I have to say, you naturally will make eye contact. You naturally will speak up. You'll naturally be listening. And those things go such a long way.
Yeah, no cheesy pre-planned pickup lines. Most girls will see right through those.
Yeah. Sometimes they're so outrageous that they'll get a laugh out of me, you know, but if they hold on to it and they're like serious with it, then no. But if they like do a super cheesy pickup line and then they laugh it off, like they know it's ridiculous and they were just trying to break the ice, that goes so much further than someone who's like, no, take it seriously. So.
Okay, because I know it's like natural instinct for a guy to want to have some sort of plan, but it's better just to be natural and just go with whatever comes out of your mouth at the time.
Yeah. As long as it's nothing like, can I smell your hair? You know, like if that's what you want to do or you really want to smell her hair, don't do that. You know, don't be
crazy. Noted. Strange, I was at a sushi restaurant with my buddy a few days ago, and there was a table of four girls sitting down. One was extremely attractive, and the other three were just way below average, if it's okay to judge. The most attractive one that we're all gawking at goes to the bathroom. I was compelled to get up, go sit in her seat when she was in the bathroom, and tell her friends, she's beautiful. Is she single? Is this a good move?
Not really. Okay. I say not really only because one, if she's the extremely attractive one and the other three are not, that means they're used to her getting all of the attention. Mm-hmm. So the better move is to show interest in them. And when she comes back, just, you know, if your interest is almost kind of goes back to like the pickup artist thing. Like, this is someone who's used to getting all the attention. So you go and you talk to her friends, and when she comes back, you just pretend like she's not the one that you like. Your dogs are talking
about. Sorry. I got them locked up. I don't know what else I can do.
But yeah, her friends are not going to help. They tend to be, I don't want to say haters almost, but they tend to not be super supportive of the girl who always gets the attention.
Okay, I can see that. Yeah, because they're used to her always getting all the love, and they're like, what about us?
Yeah.
Can you just hold on 1 second? Give the dogs a bone. I'll give them a bone. 1 second.
Look, as soon as he gets up, they instantly stop barking.
All right. I'll be occupied now. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
But yeah, in the end, I mean, I was on the edge of my seat to go do that exact thing. I've never done that, but I chickened out, and I really regretted just not even trying. Even if it would have failed, she was just so spectacular, I thought it was just worth a shot.
Yeah, you should have definitely... It's a numbers game, right? All the dating is just a numbers game. And if you don't put any pressure on yourself as far as what you hope to get out of the situation, like, don't think about, oh, maybe this could be the one, or oh, maybe this, or maybe that. Just look at it as like, look, keep trying, you know, and practice makes perfect. The more you approach, the better that you get and the more comfortable you will be. And the more situations that you put yourself into, you know, the more responsive women will become because they'll see that it's just so natural for you. So it's approaching. The only bad approach is to not approach. And that sounds so bad because there are some very awful approaches, but I feel like awful approach is better than no approach at all.
That makes sense. Yeah. If you never shoot, you're never going to score, and practice does make perfect. So you just can't fear rejection. You just got to, it's all a free roll, right? If a rejection doesn't really hurt and there's all upside, just go for it.
Yeah.
All right. I mean, I have so many notes, so much valuable knowledge you shared in your videos of magic, sex, and coffee on YouTube. Check it out. You were talking about size with men.
Size matter.
In the end, the synopsis was just put in the work.
Yeah. You know,
work
it's
with what you got.
It's so funny because I had several of my girlfriends that were like, yes, size matters. And then on the other hand, they were like, no, it doesn't matter. It's so, I don't know. Like, for me personally, I honestly believe that size doesn't matter. Now, if all men put in the same amount of work, okay, then now size matters, right? But not all men are going to put in the same amount of work. It's like saying, like, if all women gave blowjobs, you wouldn't care who you got a blowjob from, which is definitely not true because every blowjob is different. So it's just, it really leads back to the type of work that you put in.
Very good. In chat, they're saying, what's the channel name? It's just
Ebony Kenney? Look up my name, you know, or Magic, Sex, and Coffee. It all comes up, yeah.
Magic, Sex, and Coffee on YouTube. free knowledge that can really save you a lot of embarrassment in the future bedroom and just make you a better pickup artist or lover in the long run.
Yeah. I also do personal one-on-one coaching. So.
Oh, shit. And how can they contact you for that?
They can email me at ebony@ebonykenney.com. So, or just go on my website, which is, I have ebonykenney.com and magicsexandcoffee.com. I have both, but they can contact me either way through there.
Very nice. Have you been playing much poker lately?
So I actually played last night. I was playing online yesterday. So I play probably 2 to 3 times a week. And I'm trying to put poker in the backseat and really just focus on sex and dating, because it's something I've enjoyed so much. I love poker. But I've always had 1 foot in like dating and entertainment and all that stuff, and then 1 foot in poker, and never been completely committed to both, at least for the past like 4 years. So.
Okay. No, it's a lot of my friends say you don't want 1 foot out the door in any occupation. You kind of want to just go for it. You want to be the best at whatever you're going to really focus on.
Yeah, I definitely, like, I love poker so much, but it will always be there for me. And I just, now I'm like, okay, I gotta do what I love and just be true to myself. And I enjoy talking about sex, and I have no qualms about it. And I have a lot of experience. I have no qualms about that. And I'm not weirded out about what anyone may say or may think about me. So I'm okay.
It's great. Yeah. I'm guessing, talking about that's more exciting, more exciting than talking about poker, as it's all been pretty much said.
Yeah. Sometimes you get overhearing, bad beat stories, on the belt, and it's a lot more fun to hear bad beat stories about sex. So.
Yeah. Those would be more funny for sure. more entertaining, at least. In one of your videos, you referenced that, much like Lil Wayne's album, you were on a drought.
I'm still on a drought. Like, technically, I'm on a drought. But I
did. Drizzle.
So I'm still not having any sex. In like a couple days, it'll be almost 4 months. It will be 4 months. Which is insane for me. but I did start seeing someone, so we have been hanging out, but we have not yet done the deed.
Okay. No, I just thought that was interesting. Another good tip. Don't want to put too many spoilers from your website, but the handwritten letter. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Oh, I mean, obviously you're not going to write a letter to someone like you just met, right? Because that sounds, that's a little psychotic and stage 5 clinger. But if you think about romance, like the things that people typically think about is dinner and flowers, And if you really just think about the way to a woman's heart, which essentially is the way to her pussy, which is what you guys all want anyway, you have to think about communication, because foreplay for women, I'm very aggro. Your face when I said pussy. But foreplay for a woman starts here. It starts with her head, and it works its way down through her heart to her pussy. So the way to do that is communication. Like, that's the most important thing. So when you think about ways that you communicate versus ways that women communicate, you really have to appeal to her feminine side. And writing a handwritten letter is something that nobody does anymore. And it's a tangible item that she can open up. And it almost goes back to, I think nowadays no one really does it anymore. Like, the high school kids don't do it anymore. But I think it goes back to when we were kids, you know, our generation, you know, when we would write letters and you would read them. And I remember I had like boxes of letters from like all my friends and all the guys I dated and this and that. So it just, it takes you back to a time where you have a tangible item to remember something sweet. And it doesn't even have to be anything like super impressive, super romantic, whatever. It could be the worst thing ever. It could be the best thing ever. It doesn't matter. But if you took the time to write it and actually write her a letter, that's something that she will remember. And that is a definite panty dropper. Like, it's not even close.
That's a pro tip right there. Take notes, guys. On the other spectrum of what not to do, let's talk about dick pics. Oh.
God, no, there's nothing. Don't send dick pics, guys. Don't do it.
Don't do it. While no. The female body may be beautiful and we want to see nudes, girls don't view it the same way. They don't lust in the same fashion as for that part as we do for boobs and butts.
Yeah, we don't respond as well to like visually, like we just don't respond visually the way that guys do. It's it's not good.
Makes perfect sense.
I read like a meme the other day where someone said, if a guy sends you a dick pic that you didn't ask for, you send him another one that says like, look, this is a more impressive dick. This dick is going places. I didn't ask for it, so don't give it to me or else, you're going to lose this contest. So, yeah.
That's more good advice that you're putting yourself out there when you shouldn't need to, and it's not going to get any return.
It could have the opposite effect. Like it definitely for me, a guy that I did have interest in, it ended, it absolutely ended things before they even began because he just was like, I don't know. I guess he thought that if he sent, some pictures that he would get some in return, and that's just not the way it works.
Okay. So I guess in general, we're talking about unsolicited dick pics.
Yeah.
Occasionally a girl would request them and then you should follow through with that.
Yeah. I mean, if she asks for one, but I don't know many women that ask for dick pics. I don't know. Okay. Like, I mean, if they ask, then sure, send it, send away.
The only downside would be like a Brett Favre type incident if he's already involved with a woman and you're just sending them out to randoms that can, blackmail him in the future.
Yeah, that's a different scenario entirely. But yeah, we're talking if you're gonna send dick pics to somebody that's available and you are also available.
Yeah, a little bit too aggro just to be slanging them out there.
Yeah.
Excellent. Your Twitter handle is Ebony_Kenny.
It is.
Okay. So if anybody wants to get a hold of you for sex coaching, just to chat, check out what she's up to every day, feel free to check her out on Twitter. I didn't Google the word polyamorous, but I'm guessing that means a non-committed relationship and enjoying life.
It actually does not mean non-committed relationship. It means many loves. So you can be in a committed relationship and still be polyamorous. It's just not the traditional monogamous relationships that society dictates we have.
Okay, so almost like a swinger?
Ooh, yeah. So swingers are just about sex, right? They're only like, let me go to a party and just meet random whatever the fuck. And that's literally about fucking and cuckolding and swapping, and that's what that's about. But polyamory is about connection, and you as human beings, like, we have this overwhelming capacity to love and be loved, and we are not made to love one person. And the fact of the matter, like, there's proof in that, because you have parents, you have family, you have friends, you have multiple people that you care about in your life. So why does that, for me personally, I just feel like, why does that end when it comes to romance? So I, like, right now I'm single, so I'm single poly. So I am free to do whatever I want to do. Whereas when I was in a relationship, I got out of a relationship about a year ago. So when we were together, he was my primary, and then I had secondaries. So I had other people I cared about that I genuinely had feelings for, and we dated, all honesty, and it was, yeah. So, and it wasn't about, oh, let me just see how many people I can fuck. It was, these are people that I have connections with, and I'm not going to miss out on these opportunities. And yeah, so.
Okay, how do you deal with jealousy? You just, it's just not even part of it? You can just block it out?
Listen, jealousy is totally normal. I think the thing with any relationships, even if you're monogamous, is you have jealousy. Everyone's got jealousy issues, but you let those emotions happen, but you don't act on them, or you don't let them consume you. I think that's the biggest thing to try and remember. And it's hard. I mean, it's hard even in a normal relationship when you just have two people to worry about.
Okay. So. Could the jealousy be like an exciting thing where it kind of turns you on a little bit that they're with somebody else, but you want them that much more?
I mean, sometimes. I mean, there's definitely, I mean, look, people are into all kinds of shit, you know? So sometimes men and women both, whenever their partner is wanted or desired by other people, that definitely, you know, does something for the appeal factor.
Okay. So. I can see that. Makes a lot of sense. The quote that hits me the hardest out of all of your YouTube videos, someone asked, what are the keys to make a girl have a quote, mind blowing, soul on fire, body numbing, can't walk, I hope it's not done sex. Some men have provided this for you, and I'm sure a lot of men in chat want to know how to do this, because that's a lot of adjectives.
Those are amazing gifts to give to women. And I think it's take your time. Don't worry about you coming. Like, and it, just really, really take your time. Listen to her. Respond, pay attention to how she's responding to you, and act accordingly.
Makes sense. Yin and yang.
You can't ever go too slow, right? Like, sometimes, you know, fast is good, but she'll tell you, like, if she wants fast, you know, but if you just take your time, you can always speed it up, you know, but this, you want her. Just think about it this way. Like, you want her begging for it. You want her begging to give you everything that you're going to give her. So the slower that you are, the more she's going to want it, the more she's going to crave it, and the more she's going to beg for it. And whereas if you are doing the opposite and you're just going so fast, she's going to be like, can you slow down? You know, or she won't say anything and she'll just be unfulfilled and bitch to her friends, and you'll never know.
So slow is better. But isn't there some times when the girl's just like, just get it over with already, you know?
Yeah, of course. Of course. But that's the thing, and she'll tell you.
That was another good tip you said. When exploring what your partner likes and doesn't like, you should always just be open and let them know, this feels good, this doesn't feel good.
Yeah. Don't be afraid to. It might catch some people off guard initially who aren't used to communicating openly about what they do want or what they don't want in the bedroom. But once you get past that initial, first time or two that you express what you like and don't like, most partners are extremely receptive to it, and it helps your sex life tremendously. And I would dare to find somebody who tells me that communicating with their partner in the bedroom has not helped their sex life. That's just, it's crazy to me.
Yeah, so. It totally makes sense. A lot of people are just inherently shy and they don't like confrontation. They don't like rejection. But overall, it's just better just to get it out there and, you know, find out the answer.
Yeah. Well, and on top of that, it's like, okay, so what are your choices here? So you're going to sit here and you're not going to communicate about what you want. So you're just going to continuously be miserable, or if you're miserable, but you're ultimately not going to get what you want. So you continue on this with this relationship or these scenarios of things that you don't want, and you're bitching, and you're expecting your partner to be a mind reader. And then you just build it up, and then either A, it's not good enough for you and you quit, B, blow up. It's just outrageous, you know? So you have nothing to lose. And if your partner doesn't respond well, you know, and decides like, oh no, maybe it's the way that you say things, you know, maybe you're insulting them and the like, you suck, can you do this instead? You know? So it's just, think about your approach. And then if your partner still doesn't care about what you want in the bedroom, then that's not a partner that you should want for a long period of time anyway. That's not a partner you should want ever. So.
It's true. That's why it's so hard to find the perfect companion for you. And that's why I question some religions that say no sex till marriage. Couldn't that really backfire?
I mean, for sure. They're definitely, listen, most religions that say like no sex till marriage, like I'm whatever about all of that. Because compatibility and chemistry in the bedroom is so important. And you can do plenty of things to see if there's going to be compatibility, you know, like you can build, like there are so many ways to build without penetrating. And you can have plenty of non-penetration sex that will definitely let you know if you and your partner are going to have some good sex. Like, I know that the guy that I just started dating, like, I know when we do eventually have sex, it's going to be fucking spectacular because of the chemistry that we have so far. And the moments that we've shared so far have been absolutely phenomenal. So that's something that I'm sure of. But now if it was just, it was like cold and boring, then, you know, whatever.
Understandable. What are the pros and cons of waiting for, once you meet a girl, they say the third date rule is when you're supposed to consummate the relationship. What are your thoughts on waiting a specific amount of time?
I think it's stupid because every relationship is different, and you can't apply you can't put the same blanket rules over every relationship. And if you really think about it, like if you keep doing the same, it's insanity. You're going to keep doing the same thing that you've done and you expect to get a different result. And yet you're single and haven't had much success in your relationships, you know, thus far, or seemingly haven't had much, you know, success. So I think you just have to do whatever's right for that particular relationship. If you and that person want to have sex, then you have sex, and don't be concerned about how much time has passed or what people think, you know, you should do. Like my sister's like, oh, you should definitely wait for this guy. And I'm like, listen, I'm an adult. Like I'm going to be 35 in a few weeks. I'm too fucking grown to sit here and let other people dictate how long I should wait to have sex with somebody.
Makes sense. You just go with the flow. There shouldn't be a set time frame. I agree with that.
Yeah.
But on the other hand,
a lot of women have, there's so much pressure for women to be like, you want to be like virginal and like be like good and wholesome for your guy. It's like, but then at the same time, the guy wants you to like fucking know everything in the bedroom and be a freak. And it's like, listen, what, why? There's so much pressure in for women. I think they have to get out of their own head and be confident in their decision-making abilities in regards to like, if you want to have sex, don't have any shame in it.
Yeah, I wonder the psychology of women and the way they feel about when they give it up compared to how the guy's going to look at it, and if they want to, if they would give it up on the first date. They just assume the guy is just not going to be as interested in them, or they'll look at them as a type of way.
Yeah. I mean, and unfortunately that stuff still happens. And if you're, for me, like I went through those moments where I would do things and I've always done what I wanted to do, but I carried like this element of shame with me, in regards to like, oh my God. And I made myself feel like shit because of decisions that I was making that I wanted to make, but I felt bad about, but only because other people were making me feel bad about it. Okay. And so I think it's just a matter of just really, really owning your shit, being true to yourself and deciding like, look, if I want to fuck you, I'm going to fuck you and I'm not going to feel bad about it. You know, and if I don't want to, it's because I don't want to, and, or I'm not ready, you know? And I think a lot of women have, it's very, very difficult just based on what society has deemed what's appropriate for women to do and not do.
Yeah. The old slut shaming movement and just the psychology. I mean, I can't really get into women's minds that much, but if they're like, if they give you the green light on the second date, but they say no anyway, just because they want to postpone it, so it'll be a greater gift to unwrap when the time comes.
Yeah.
Better not to worry about what other people think and just do what you feel is right.
Yeah, I mean, you could, the way that I explain it to women especially is like, look, you can tell your friends everything that's going on from the time that you meet this person, but they're still only going to get one part of the story, right? There's your side, his side, and then what actually happens between the two of you. And the only people that know that are the two people that are involved. So no one can possibly grasp how intense a connection is, or how, you know, the actual feelings of a relationship, or when it's ready. Because sometimes, a third date is not enough time for you to decide that you're with someone. And sometimes you know right away if you want to fuck somebody. So, and if you want to not only have sex with somebody, but if you want to continuously try and grow into something and see where it can go, you know, sometimes you don't know that right away. Sometimes you do. Sometimes it takes months. Sometimes it takes minutes. So.
For sure. Kind of along the same subject, but recently I was at a steak dinner with some poker players and we were talking about STDs for some reason, and I got in a big prop bet that no one at the table has ever asked their partner if they had an STD. I took, of course, someone had to ask at some time before they had sex. Between four guys, they're all 30 years old or so. I lost, and all of them said, "Why would I ask?" She's either gonna say no and lie to me, or she's going to say no and be completely offended. So it's like a negative free roll, which I thought was ridiculous because that seems like a pretty important question.
Can you block this guy? Sorry. block. You see what he's writing?
DM?
Yeah, that guy.
Okay.
Like permablock?
block. Got him. Did that work?
Yes, perfect. Thank you.
No problem.
I just see it over and over and I'm like, okay.
Yeah, that's for sure.
Yeah.
But STDs, what's the deal?
It's so funny. People are so weirded out about asking, and it doesn't make any sense. Like, this is your health. This is your life. Why would you not ask? Like, this is a conversation that I have with every one of my partners. I find out, when was the last time they got tested? I have no qualms. And I didn't start actively asking until I was probably in my mid to late 20s. And I think the reason was just that I was not comfortable. And I felt like if I asked, then maybe it would look like I was the one that had an STD. And there was just this stigma that was attached to it because it seemed like I was opening a can of worms. But I had a partner for 2.5 years, and we saw other people, and we actively would go and get tested together. And that was one of the things that we would go and get tested together and we would send each other our results. And we always did that. And it helped me become a lot more confident in bringing it up. And I think it's just, it's a seemingly tough topic to talk about, but it's not, because it's your fucking life. It's your health.
I agree. Maybe not in the heat of the moment, but you should bring it up before you're about to.
Yeah, it's honestly, it's one of those things. It's such an easy conversation. To when you talk about like, oh, you've been dating, or you know, it's this and it's that, and you just say, you know, like, listen, you know, we're thinking about doing this, you know, how many partners have you had? I don't need to know how many partners you've had, but when was the last time that you got tested? And it's not about, some people are like, oh, well, I've only been with one person in the past, you know, X amount of years, so I don't need to get tested. And it's like, it doesn't matter. You still need to get tested, period.
Yeah, I agree.
So, yeah, someone says it's a mood killer to bring it up on a date. Yeah, mm-hmm. So what? You know what else is a mood killer? HIV.
Yeah, or chlamydia, gonorrhea, whatever the hell they got out there that will ruin the rest of your life just because you didn't ask a simple question.
Chlamydia goes away, but the other ones do not. So, yeah.
Yeah, that's the gift that keeps on giving that you don't want, let me tell you. I wouldn't know, but I can only imagine that would tilt me more than anything, getting that present from unsuspected individual.
Yeah, it's really tough. Like I've had some girlfriends, you know, that's how they find out their partner's cheating. you know, it's insane. It's really insane.
So. Yeah, it was that and two other questions that I brought up with my buddies at that steak dinner that they were just kind of amused that they were such awkward questions, but yet they're still never brought up. The other one was a paternity test. Could be awkward to ask, but that's need to know information.
Well, I think that's also, I mean, if you're talking paternity test now you're talking a deeper level of trust and, you know, discerning partners, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a different thing altogether. And that's a bigger. So yeah, if you have a partner that you're worried about paternity, then you should definitely be worried about STDs as well.
Yep, kind of goes together, but can you imagine raising a kid for 18 years and you find out it's not even yours, or you're paying child support and that she cheated on you? I mean, this is going to be an awkward situation, but you got to get down to it. You got to just ask, you got to figure it out, or just make her take the test.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. But again, that's just a different, there's bigger problems there. Bigger problems, underlying problems there if you're worried about being the father of a child, so.
Okay. And the third awkward question that I thought about with relationships, about to get married, prenup. How do you deliver that without offending either party?
So I'm a fan of prenups, and the reason is because I did not grow up thinking about, I didn't grow up planning my wedding. I didn't grow up thinking about what dress I was going to marry. I'm like the realistic romantic, right? So for me, when I think about marriage, like this is such it's a business decision, right? And you're going to take all of this stuff and all of these things that you've built or not built or you hope to build, and you're going to risk all of that for an emotional decision. And when you're emotional, you just you don't really think clearly. So I don't see a problem with prenup, because if you're committing to somebody, you're telling them, it shouldn't be offensive that you say, listen, if you don't fulfill the duties that have been outlined in this marriage, then you shouldn't be obligated to be getting, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and vice versa. And just like a prenup becomes null and void if somebody you know, cheats. So if the guy that's presenting the prenup is the cheater, then guess what? Merry Christmas to you. You get to take, you get to, you know, rake them over the coals. But I just feel like people, where you are on an emotional high when you're in love, you know, and you make all of these really great decisions. If you look at it the opposite way, like, you're going to make all of these really awful, you're almost going to become an awful human being when it comes to divorce and, you know, if it ends badly. So I just feel like prenup is for sure a good thing to have. I have no qualms about it. I've never been married. I've been engaged, but yeah, so.
I agree.
I don't hear an echo.
Okay. I agree 100% with the prenup. Marriage shouldn't be a for-profit decision. You should be with the person for life for a reason. And I mean, I've never been married. Don't really plan on it. But I don't think marriage contracts should really be a thing. If you got an agreement not to cheat, not, you know, to be faithful, you want to be get together forever, why get the law involved? They make enough money off taxes as it is. They don't need to get in your business.
Well, I do believe that some like, you can get married for strategic purposes to protect each other, you know, or to help each other for businesses or whatever, you know. And one of my friends, like one of my guy friends, actually, he's been saying for like 2 years, like, okay, Ebony, look, let's just get married for a year. If it doesn't work, you know, I'll set you and the kids up for a year and like whatever, but let's just try this for a year. He's like, you know, and he's like, you have to sign a prenup, blah, blah, blah. And he's one of my best friends. And I'm like, sure, okay, you know. But then and he's like, he doesn't ever take me seriously. So I'm waiting for the day that he does take it seriously, because that's something that, like, that's us actually making a business decision, not because we're so in love and we have these distorted ideas of what our marriage is going to be like.
Wow. So. It's like an indecent proposal, a little trial, trial and error.
Yeah.
Well, that's, about sex, marriage, STDs. Is there anything else you wanted to touch on?
I don't know.
We can check out some of these comments I've been focused on, but I'm sure there's a lot of funny, funny comments in the YouTube chatter.
Yeah, there's a ton.
Any of them stand out to you?
Let's see. I scrolled up a little bit. So a lot of people were like, is this the room that Joey was in last week? Yes, Joey was here in California for a few weeks, Joey Ingram, and he stayed at three different homes while he was here, and mine was one of them. So yes, and no, we're not fucking. So for those that are asking.
Bang bang, there you go.
So a lot of people asked that in the chat.
I can see how they could come up with that, as Joey seems to be a lover of women and you love sex. Only seems natural.
Yeah, but no, we're friends.
Just be friends.
Yeah, we've been friends for a few years now, and we're good. We're good on that.
Okay. Laminate 7 asks, social justice warrior? ?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just a believer that, you know, guess what? If you guys get to, you know, it's cool to be players, then so what? You know, like I constantly call the guys that I'm dating, I say that I have a roster. And people always respond like, what the fuck? You have a roster? And I'm like, yeah, sometimes it's like I don't even have enough for a fucking starting lineup for a basketball team, you know, but other times, I'm good, you know, I'm full. So, you know, right now my roster is pretty fucking empty.
Okay.
But I have no qualms about owning my shit. And I think that's the thing, is like, there are a lot of a lot of women who are like secret hoes. And I don't say hoes in like a bad way, or secret sluts. You know what I mean? Where they're the ones that are like, they're doing all kinds of shit, and they're the ones that are like slut shaming and like throwing stones and like, and I can't believe blah, blah, blah. But they're the ones that are secretly like fucking everybody. I can't stand women like that. And I can't stand men who also do shit like that. And there are a ton of them. So for me, I look at it like, look, I'm going to take all your power away from you in regards to me, because I'm going to be open and honest about everything I do. And anything you say to me, I don't care. Anything you say about me, I don't care. Like, you're going to give me some good fodder, some good entertainment, and I can laugh, and I can choose to be offended if I want to be offended. But 99% of the time, I'm just going to be extremely entertained by it and thank you for it and move on and continue having all the sex I want to have or not have. So.
Yeah, they're just hypocrites.
Yeah. So, or just super, even the ones who are just with one person and they only believe in monogamy and marriage forever and blah, blah, blah. Like, they're just over there eating their popcorn, judging hardcore, and, you know, nose fucking ankles deep in my life. And
haters.
So.
Just haters. Let's see, where is he? Someone said that Ebony will be my next outro girl. I don't know if you're familiar with my videos, but at the end of my vlogs, I have a beautiful woman, usually a waitress or a porn star, say, watch Jeff Boski on YouTube.
Wait, how do you get, that's so great. How do you get these porn stars to, really?
Funny, yeah, oh yeah, everyone, 90% of them.
Wow. That's so great. How do you do that?
luckily, in January, there was the Avian Porn Expo in town that I went to for the first time with my buddies. And they're very friendly. That we're all their fans or whatever. So they're really appreciative for us to go there, get their autograph, get our picture taken, get a video with them. And they were more than happy to say whatever I asked them to say for the camera. And every time I'd say I got a YouTube channel, like, their eyes would just perked up, like, what? You gotta, like, anybody can have a YouTube channel and it's nothing special, but they're like, oh shit, that's awesome. And I just said, I mean, they could have said anything, but all I could think about was just them doing like a little promo, watch Jeff Boski on YouTube, and 97% of my viewers are male, so I figure it's a pretty good strategy for the demographic.
Yeah, for sure. That's so awesome, and that's brilliant on your part.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I did get one that wasn't at the AVN Awards, Jessie Jane. Apparently, okay. She's pretty popular just by going on Instagram and hitting the contact info. And I just made like a stock letter of, this is me. This is what I want you to do, to send me a video, please. And she responded to my email, sent me a great video. And I'd featured that in probably my last 5 videos. And it's awesome free publicity for both of us.
Oh my God, that's so dope. That's so great.
Yeah, it's fun. And, you know, just talking to the females at the AVN Awards, just making me more sociable and, you know, dealing with movie stars, as I'd call them. And they'd be like, oh, yeah, movie star, that's me. but now I'm targeting, that's a bad word. I'm approaching waitresses at casinos that I think are pretty and asking them to do the same thing. And they have no problem with it. And it's real cool.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. So if you want to say, watch Jeff Boski on YouTube, I could probably capture the video and use it in my next video if you want.
Oh, my God, that's so great. All right, I'm going through the... the phone. Da-da-da. A lot of people had stuff to say about the prenups.
Oh, I didn't get there yet. Still scrolling down. Chlamydia, you take 2 to 3 pills and it's gone. Is that true?
I believe so.
Oh, you get the Amber Rose thing a lot, I take it?
I do. Yeah.
Do you like that, or are you just tired of hearing it?
Look, I think she's beautiful, and you know, it does get old. But I just have to remember that most people that are saying it, this is the first time that they've seen me, so it's not old for them. Yeah. Just like people saying Ebony and Ivory are singing that song to me, you know, it's old for me, but it's not to them. So I just have to remember that.
I don't get that reference. What do you mean, Ebony and Ivory?
You never heard the song Ebony and Ivory?
No.
Oh.
Was it from the 90s?
It's from the 80s. How do you? Close. What? Stevie Wonder and Paul McCartney, they sing Ebony and Ivory. You've seriously never heard that song?
I know most music, but I've never heard that one.
What? Oh my gosh.
Rap, hip hop, alternative. I've heard all that. Oldies, just missed the 80s, I guess.
That is crazy.
No, but so people are good. Michael
Jackson and McCartney. It's actually not Michael Jackson. It's Stevie Wonder and Paul McCartney.
Okay.
So that is hilarious. What? Let's see.
Virginia. Yeah, this was a.
They're calling you Virgin. That's hilarious. But they're saying Virginia.
Me?
Someone's gonna throw stones. They have to say the right, like, spell things correctly.
Confirmed Virgin. I am I'm a Mormon. No, I'm not.
I was like, what?
No. No.
Oh my gosh.
They want more poker talk. No, this is a segment for PokerTube. Exclusive interviews you won't hear anywhere else. Not your average poker grinders. My last interview, if you want to check it out, was with Michael Haig, an ex-convict that is now a Las Vegas poker pro. You can find that on PokerTube.com. Getting rave reviews. This will be released in a few weeks with Ebony. Ebony Kenney on Twitter. Make sure you check out her channel on YouTube, Magic, Sex, and Coffee. What year were you a WPT player to watch?
I was the ones to watch in 2012. Yeah, so several years ago now, 5 years ago.
Yeah, game flies by.
Yeah, and that was back when I lived in Florida, so, and I've been in California now for a year and a half, so.
You like California better than Florida?
I love the weather, and I love the lifestyle. I don't like how expensive it is. And I live in South Orange County, which is like the epitome of super wealthy. It's the Housewives of OC. Like, everybody down here is like that. And so my kids go to school with kids like that. It's insane. So I'm having a hard time finding like genuine friendships, genuine relationships with people. And I don't mean like, oh, boyfriend, girlfriend. I just mean establishing, like, finding people that are not fleaky and not fake. And you get that a lot down here. Or people who don't care about, who only care about money. Like, that seems to be a thing down here. There's so much money, and it's super white. I'm half black, so, and me being half black is like way too black for a lot of people down here. It's insane. Wow. So so I'm getting accustomed to that part.
Okay. Do you ever go to like yoga classes or any other stuff like that to meet people?
Yeah, so I just started going back to CrossFit. So I started back in January. So that has actually helped a lot. Like, I actually have gone out like for drinks and dinner with a couple girls from CrossFit, and I'll be doing a competition in like a month and a half, a partner competition. So that has helped me, you know, make some friends, and kind of, that helps a lot. And I do Bikram yoga, but that's more like, you know, I show up, I do my practice, and you kind of talk about the practice, but you leave and that's it. So yeah, but other than that, I mean, I want to start, acro yoga. But most of it is like in LA. So, and I'm an hour from LA, so I would have to drive, and I do go to LA still twice a week, three times a week to play poker, to play live. But I go like 40 minutes away. So.
Okay. It's all part of that California lifestyle. Traffic, good weather, expensive living.
So expensive. I just switched apartments. Yeah. And I came from Florida with, there's no state taxes in Florida. So this year will be the first full year that I've been in California paying, California taxes. So I'm not excited about that. But it's crazy, but it's beautiful. But for sure. I just switched apartments last week. Or 2 weeks ago, I was paying a two bedroom apartment with a den. I was paying $3,200 a month for a two bedroom.
Brutal.
I mean, it's insane. It's just so I can have my kids in the best schools, you know, but I switched and moved to a little smaller apartment in the same community. So I'm paying cheaper now. So.
Yeah, that's important.
Yeah.
That is important. Well, Ebony, it was a pleasure talking to you. Hopefully we can do this again or meet up sometime. You seem like a very smart, motivated girl. Poker, magic, sex, and coffee on YouTube. Check it out. Little Adam and Eve affiliate. If you ever want any products from adamandeve.com, check out her affiliate link. She's living it up in California. And us over at PokerTube are glad to have her. Featured on the channel, check out pokertube.com, and you will see this interview in its entirety in the near future.